But here's a problem you should be able to do for the gateway. Integrate, and I'll start relatively easy here. Sine of x to the fourth, written like that, times cosine of x. I could make it a little harder. I could make it a cos cubed x, or maybe even a cos to the fifth x. Still ends up being possible. This one's going to be a little easier. I'll do harder examples next week. The way you want to do this is with substitution. And if you've got an odd power of cosine like we do here, cos to the first power, you want to let w be the sine. Because then dw is going to be sitting there for you. It's just cos to the first power dx. If it were a cos cubed, it's a little trickier. You got to use a trigonometric identity as well, but let's keep it simple for today. If you do the substitution, this becomes the integral of w to the fourth dw. The answer is 1/5 w to the fifth plus c, but then remember to go back to x. The final answer is 1/5 sine of x to the fifth power plus c. And as usual with substitution, you can check it with the chain rule. Instead of doing another example that's a little harder today, we'll save that for Monday. What I want to do the last 10 minutes is I want to try to explain why you change the limits of integration with substitution for definite integrals. Now, I kind of messed up this explanation in the first class. I'm going to try to do it better for you guys, okay? Let's consider this same example as a definite integral. And we'll try to keep it fairly simple. Let's go integral from 0 to pi over 6, say, of sine of x to the fourth power times cosine of x dx. Okay, I'm going to do this two ways. And for both ways, I'm also going to write the method in a more abstract way. And writing it in the abstract way is supposed to explain why you change the limits of integration for definite integrals when you do substitution. Now, since I've already gotten the antiderivative with substitution, the first way I showed you to do this last week was to go ahead and just use that answer. We've got an antiderivative because we use substitution to help us. Now go ahead and use it. That was the first way I showed you. And then you use the same limits of integration, 0 to pi over 6. And what would you get? You'd get 1/5 sine of pi over 6 to the fifth power minus 1/5 sine of 0 to the fifth power. Sine of pi over 6 is something you should know. It's 1/2. And of course, sine of 0 is something you should know. It's what? 0. You get 1/5 times 1 over 32, which is 1 over 160 is the answer. The graph's pretty close to the axis. It's a pretty small area. Okay, what if we had done it the second way? Let's leave some space here, and I'd suggest doing this on your paper too. Leave some space. And let's do the second way, but by changing the limits of integration with the substitution. In other words, do that integral, w to the fourth, based on the substitution, and change the limits of integration. Now, I made it a little simpler in that the lower limit actually doesn't change because sine of 0 is 0. Right, I use this equation right here, if I'm going to use it in this form, to figure out my new limits of integration. When x is 0, w is sine of 0, but sine of 0 is 0. However, this one will change. When x is pi over 6, w is sine of pi over 6, which is 1/2. It's no coincidence that we have a half there. The new limit of integration, the upper limit, is 1/2 of w to the fourth dw. And you end up doing the same final calculation in these last couple steps. That's what happens. You do the integral in terms of w with the new limits of integration, and the same final calculation happens. And here we're using w, we're not going back to x. We're not using the sine function anymore, but it is the same final couple steps, right? That's the same final couple steps. And the same final answer. Okay, so it helps you see it for an example here that you're gonna get the same thing. It's really the same final couple steps. But let's, to be a bit more rigorous about this, try to think about this in an abstract way. And this was the part with the first section, I messed it up. I should have approached it like I'm approaching with you guys here. What I wanna do is I wanna think of this function, my original function, in kind of a complicated way, though an accurate way, as say little f of g of x times g prime of x, which is certainly a fine thing to do if I let little f of x be the outside function for sine of x to the fourth, which is x to the fourth, g of x be the inside function for sine of x to the fourth, which is sine of x. And hey, yeah, if g of x is sine of x, then g prime of x is cosine of x. Right? You see that matches this function here? F of g of x, I need to plug sine of x into the x to the fourth function. That does give me sine of x to the fourth power, which is what this notation means. Do the sine function first and then raise to the fourth power. And cosine of x, it's being multiplied, is g prime. You know, this kind of thing looks something similar to what you would get in the chain with a chain rule, right? When you take the derivative of f of g of x, you take the derivative of the outside, plug in the inside, then multiply times the derivative of the inside. But wait a minute. What's little f the derivative of? It's the derivative of, look at this, it's the derivative of 1/5 x to the fifth. If I let capital F of x be 1/5 x to the fifth, that means capital F of g of x, well, first of all, it means the derivative of capital F is little f, right? Capital F is an antiderivative of little f. And it also means if I plug g of x, the sine function, into here, I get 1/5 sine of x to the fifth power. Hey, I've seen that before right there. In other words, yeah, this thing is an antiderivative of that thing. That's what I use from up here. In abstract form, if I differentiate ddx of capital F of g of x, here's the chain rule right now, chain rule in abstract form, I get capital F prime of g of x times the derivative of the inside function, but capital F prime is little f. Yeah, there's an abstract way of confirming that when capital F is an antiderivative of little f, then capital F of g of x is an antiderivative of my original function. And then by the fundamental theorem of calculus, I could write this definite integral as capital F of g of the upper limit, pi over 6, minus capital F of g of the lower limit, 0. And that's exactly what I did right here. I know this is a lot of seems like going around in circles here. Let's think about this thing with the fundamental theorem of calculus as well. What is w to the fourth? That's really little f, except with a w instead of an x. This is little f of w, right? Because I said little f of x is x to the fourth, therefore little f of w is w to the fourth. It's the same function, it's just a different variable name. I already know capital F is an antiderivative of little f. Use a w instead of an x. The fundamental theorem of calculus will say that this integral is capital F of 1/2 minus capital F of 0. Exactly what I did right here. And I can relate it even abstractly to this thing by realizing, here's the final kicker, that 1/2 is the same as g of pi over 6. Sine of pi over 6 is 1/2. And 0 is the same as g of 0. This is the same as capital F of g of pi over 6 minus capital F of g of 0. You get the same thing even in abstract form. So that's illustrating in a very confusing, admittedly, way why you get the same thing. Why did I show you this? Because I did want to show you there's reasons for things. Now, you may have felt really confused and like, I don't need to know this. You don't need to know it for a test, but I hope you desire to learn why things work anyway. And if you really, really want to get it, if you feel confused, you will have the video, you can watch it again, okay? And you can try to reason through it. If you like thinking about logic, I would encourage you to do so. I'm not going to test you on this though, okay? Have a good day.